Good morning and welcome to the USC You Said Parent Consumer Webinar Series. Today's webinar is on the CaPROMISE Initiative. We'll learn today about a study on increasing self-sufficiency of students with disabilities on SSI and their families. Today is August 27, 2015, and we're joined by over 206 family members and dedicated professionals from up and down the state of California and from a lot of other states across the country, including Arkansas, Colorado, District of Columbia, Illinois, Kansas, Maryland, North Dakota, Oregon, Tennessee, and Texas. So we've got a lot of folks across the country. My name is Susan Kanagawa. I'll be your moderator and host today. I'm the Family Support Coordinator at the USC University Center for Excellence in Developmental Disabilities at Children's Hospital, Los Angeles. Today's webinar is the eighth in a series of policy webinars that we'll be conducting this year. We're planning one webinar discussion per month. I hope you'll be able to join us for future webinars as well. Before we get started, I'd like to review the logistics for our webinar today. Our speakers will be covering a lot of information that might be new to many of us, so I encourage you to take notes so you can review the material later. There is a meeting temperature slider at the bottom of your screen, and this is how it works. We'll ask you a couple of questions during the webinar. Please indicate your response by moving the slider with your mouse to the left or to the right. The computer records the answers from the group to give us presenters a general idea of how we're doing. Also, there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions of our speakers, Joe and Fred. Please type your questions at any time during the webinar using the Ask a Question button on the top left of your screen. We'll answer as many questions as possible after the presentation. It'll help us if you please identify yourself as a parent or a professional before you type in your question. This webinar is scheduled to last for an hour. We'll actually finish about 5 minutes early at 10:55. When the webinar is done, please don't close your internet browser because a survey will automatically appear on your screen as soon as the webinar is done. And if you could please use those last few minutes to answer the survey and help us improve, we'd greatly appreciate it. If you registered early, you should have received an email from us this morning or last night with the PowerPoint slides as an attachment. You can download them, print them, and share them freely with your family, friends, and colleagues. We'll also be posting a recording of this webinar on YouTube, and we'll let you know as soon as it's available. Please share that recording with anyone in your community as well. So our first poll of the day, so you're going to use your meeting temperature slider. Can you hear me well? So can you please indicate by moving the temperature slider to hot if you can hear me well, and to cold if there's a sound problem? Oh, yay. It's looking good. Okay, I'm very happy to hear that because you are on mute. So I'm afraid I won't be able to hear your voices. Now, Joe, can you say a few words, please?
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the webinar.
Okay, can everybody hear Joe? Can you please move your slider? Okay, Joe, I think you're going to need to raise your voice a little bit.
Let me try that again. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the webinar.
Okay, a little better. Yeah, a little bit better. If you could please use your outdoor voice, that'd be great.
And one of the things I've never been accused of is being soft-spoken, so I will speak up.
Okay. And Fred, can you say a few words, please?
Sure. Good morning. And I look forward to this morning and especially to hearing your questions.
Awesome. And everyone, were you able to hear Fred okay? I think Fred, too, if you could talk a little louder, it would help. Okay?
Okay. No problem.
So I know myself, I'm practically hollering. All right. So those of you listening can post a message in the chat box if you think we need to speak louder during the webinar, and we'll try to heed that, and I'll interrupt Joe and Fred and let them know if that's needed. Thank you. All right. So here is our presentation today, and here are our presenters. Our presenters are Joe Xavier, the Director of the California Department of Rehabilitation, and Fred McFarlane, a Professor Emeritus and Co-Director of the Interwork Institute at San Diego State University. And now it's my pleasure to turn over the microphone to Joe and Fred.
Thank you, Susan. I really appreciate your welcome, and hello to everybody around the United States as it is, hearing all the states that are participating. So I'm going to start, if you are tracking on the slides, I'm going to start on slide 8 of the presentation. What is the goal of CalPROMISE? And you have the bullets in front of you, and I'm just going to add a little bit to what those bullets speak about. And for those of you who don't know, I am an individual with a disability. I am blind. And so I have personal experience with having gone on to supplemental security income as a youth, and then the ability to move on using that as a pathway. And really what the objective of CalPROMISE is, for me, in a very personal way, is to give all of our students and their families the same opportunity that I had, the opportunity for an education, the opportunity for meaningful employment, the opportunity to gain my independence, and certainly to enjoy equality in society and in community. I think it's really incumbent upon all of us as a goal of CalPROMISE to maximize the ability and the talent of the students that we're serving. And certainly one of the things, one of the objectives is to provide the financial planning so that individuals can transition from being on benefits into that gainful employment, which will take them way beyond benefits. Let me talk a little bit on slide 9 about what are the challenges to self-sufficiency. Society's low expectation. Society believing that I, as a person with a disability, and the students that are in the study have the ability and the capacity to go on and do much more than what they're expected of at this point. The fear of letting go of benefits. It is a reality that when you are relying on supplemental security income, letting go of that can be a great fear. And then, of course, linked back to society's low expectations is the underdevelopment of the soft skills of the job readiness so that I and the students who are on the study could move into that employment opportunity. And then the belief and the confidence that each of the students needs to have in themselves to go out and to be successful. In addition to that, you have overcoming the fear of the unknown. Will I be successful? What happens if I'm not successful? And if I am not successful, do I lose everything I've had? So those are just some of the challenges that we face as we have stood up CalPROMISE and as we move it forward. So I'm going to stop my comments there and turn this over to Fred to handle the next few slides.
Okay. Thanks, Joe. When this proposal was conceptualized for California, and I would go back and add that there are 5 other demonstration sites around the country, one in Maryland, New York. There's an interesting one that covers 6 states in the Central Plains area. Arkansas has one. The state of Wisconsin also has a program. But each one of them were designed uniquely to address the characteristics of the students and their family members within the states that were a part of that. In California, obviously, we have a huge population, but it's also rich in diversity across virtually every dimension. And when we worked with the Department of Rehabilitation and with the schools, and we'll touch on those in a few moments, we identified four primary objectives. And to kind of place this in a context, it is a research and demonstration project, so we're held accountable to some research requirements and, as you might imagine, numerous reporting requirements that go with that. So we had to conform to those types of criteria. The first objective is that we would select, and this is done on a random basis, 1,539 SSI recipients between the ages of 14 and 16. The target range is that 14 to 16 for enrollment, but since it's a five-year study, obviously those children as they start will become young adults by the time they finish. The research design requires a control and an experimental group, so there is an additional equal number of recipients who are in the usual services group. So altogether, it's just over 3,000 participants that have been identified in California. The second objective is to involve state agencies and focusing on systemic or policy and practices that impact the child with on SSI and their families. I would add parenthetically that the family piece is an essential component. So it's not just working with the child, it's working with that family constellation as a part of that. And Joe will touch on the state agency partners in a moment. On slide 11, it identifies objectives 3 and 4. And objective 3 talks about it being a student and family-driven service delivery system. And it really is driven by the needs of the individual students and the families. So it is idiosyncratic to those needs. It's coordinated through 18 local education partners, and we'll describe those in a few moments. And the intent, just as Joe had indicated, is to increase the child's self-sufficiency as well as the family's economic independence. A really unique part of this entire research design is that the opportunity is to work with the child, but also to provide supports to the family members, both siblings as well as parents, that are associated with the child. And then the final objective is to implement a five-year research and evaluation to really see what differences have been made and to look at that both from a quantitative standpoint, but from our standpoint, also from the quality of what occurs. Joe has used a term on a number of occasions as we've worked together, and I hope you don't mind if I use that, Joe, is that if we're not doing things different than we did in the first year, in our sixth year, then we probably haven't done a real good job. So looking at this issue of policy implications and improving services to the child and to their family is a key element. Joe, you want to pick up on slide 12?
I will do that. So thank you. So what are the objectives and the values of CalPROMISE? Individual maximizes their talent and ability. And it really what we're talking about here is that, you know, someone that has the desire to go on and become an educator has the opportunity to go there, or someone that chooses to go into vocational rehabilitation as a counselor and who knows one day a director has the opportunity to do that. It's really about the individual student knowing that they can pursue that dream and getting the support to do so. It's the identification of the policy changes you've already heard alluded to. What are the policies that we need to take a look at that we can realign to make a greater difference, and not just the study group that we have, but certainly all of the youth that fit that qualification today and in years to come. And then, of course, along with that is the identification of the systemic changes that need to be made so that we can move forward on the policy, the program, and the services. And then, of course, in doing so, we want to ensure that the solutions are inclusive of a broad perspective. So in addition to all of you who are on this call today, we have had a number of other forums, and we'll continue to have so, and I'll talk about state partners here in a second, where we ensure that we're getting as broad a perspective in the conversation as we can. So, and in speaking of state agency partners, I would be remiss, although Fred and I have the opportunity to present to you, if I did not acknowledge a great team that has come together here in California, and certainly we have a number of our Department of Rehabilitation who are very deeply involved in leading this effort on the call, so we want a big shout out to them, Junie, Jeff, Sylvia, and many, many others, and then of course the team of local agencies that Fred will touch on. So on the state agency partners, who are they? It's the Department of Rehabilitation, it's the Department of Education, the Department of Developmental Services, the Department of Healthcare Services, and the Department of Social Services, as well as our Employment Development Department. Why did the Department of Rehabilitation take this on? This is not typically a population that we have served. It's not traditionally a population that we would engage with, probably not until 17 or 18. But one of the things that we truly believed was that by touching this population at an earlier age, it can have significant influence and significant contributions to achieving those objectives that we spoke of and accomplishing, putting forth those values that we just spoke about, which is really about moving out of dependency on benefits to moving into competitive, integrated employment that provides the students and their families with the ability to really enjoy more fully life and to do all the things that they want to do. And of course, these departments, each of these departments owns a policy or a system that either the student or the family is linked to. And each of these is a department that we would need to effectively engage with, both from a policy and a systems perspective, to affect any of the solutions that will be brought about from this study and to affect the real outcome about doing something different in year six. So let me stop there and turn this back over to Fred to pick up on slide 14.
Okay. As Joe had indicated, there are the five state agencies plus the Department of Rehabilitation at the state level. But the key that we felt was to drive this from the community level as well. The Department of Rehabilitation has had a long-standing working relationship with a number of local education agencies. As you'll notice on slide 14, there are 18 local education agencies that are involved. Those were selected based on two or three criteria. One was we had to solicit and enroll a certain number of students. So we had to look at information about the number of SSI recipients in various zip codes and geographic areas. So while it covers about 70% of the population of the state, it doesn't include every county. And again, we had to look at where the greatest population was. All of the school districts or all of the local education agencies that are involved have also been in partnership with the Department of Rehabilitation through either their workability program or their transition program. So there was a history of collegiality and collaboration that existed as a part of that. One additional, and this was in Northern California, Expandability, a community-based organization, took the lead on working with three separate school districts in that area, or three separate education agencies. I've used the term school district a couple of times. A number of these are unified districts, and when we add all of the local school districts, the individual school districts that are involved, there's over 130 school districts that are touched on with these areas. The second group was in working with a statewide network of family resource centers. Again, we did the same thing. We went back and looked at those geographic areas. We looked at the schools as where they were located. And then we looked at the family resource centers that were available in their respective communities. As we indicated in the objective, this really is a two-part research and demonstration project, working both with the child but also working with the family members as a part of it. So the statewide network of family resource centers, there are 16 family resource centers that are engaged throughout the state, and they work in partnership with the local education agencies. Our role at the university is to provide the research and evaluation, to provide the training and technical assistance, and then also to provide the technology support with regard to gathering all of this information that's a part of it. And to work in collaboration with both the Department of Rehabilitation, but also the other state agencies and the local education agencies. We've divided the local education agencies into four regions. So there's a region in the north, a region in the LA, greater LA area, one in Southern California, and then one more in the Inland Valley area. Within each of the regions, there is an educator from one of the local education agencies who serves as a regional manager, and they, along with the colleagues in the schools, are really the ones that are implementing the program. So that's the structure. It's a relatively complex structure, but we have found in working with everybody from the Department of Rehabilitation through the state agencies and the community partners a very strong commitment to providing student-driven services and approaches that will make a difference for individuals, but also to be used as a way to look at how can we improve the supports that are provided in the future. So if we can go then to slide 15, we've identified, and this was done in concert with the funding agency and the other partners, we've identified five categories of interventions that are provided generally with the students or available to the students. I would add parenthetically that when we designed the structure, we had to look at how would we configure the supports that would be provided to the individual student and their family. We identified a rich staffing ratio, or at least we thought it was going to be rich, of one career service coordinator who's hired through the school districts that we just mentioned. And they will have the responsibility, or do now have the responsibility, for up to 26 students who are on SSI. At first blush, 1 to 26 seems like a very rich ratio. But when one considers that they're also working with the family members, both immediate as well as extended family members, many times the group that they're working with is in excess of 100 persons. And the only parameters that we provided with regard to interventions were to provide services that would go back to the objectives of the program and that Joe had talked about, increasing self-sufficiency, increasing employability, increasing their ability to live independently, and to also participate and develop sound financial planning. So as we look at the different interventions, the first intervention is around case management services and transition planning. You'll see on the slide that there are three types of interventions, but those are used for purposes of illustration. So it's looking at identifying resources and services in the local communities that will benefit them. It's looking at how to access other services from both government and non-government organizations. And it's ensuring that there's a transition plan for each student in setting their goals and helping them move through the K-12 environment and then into post-secondary education in the broadest sense, which could include training and work experiences, and then eventually into competitive employment. So the first intervention is around the area of case management. The next slide addresses the area of financial planning and benefits counseling. We expanded it beyond just benefits counseling because we really do believe it's about financial planning for the future. Each of the career service coordinators that are working with the schools have gone through training with Cornell University to become certified benefit planners. They're in the middle of that process. A number of them have already completed it, and others are working with provisional certification. But we wanted to not have it just be about the benefits. We really wanted it to look at financial planning. So you'll notice we look at work incentives, we look at dealing with wages, asset accumulation, and financial literacy. Those are factors that are addressed, again, with each student and their family, and there's a series of approaches. The third area is career and work-based learning experiences, and there's a number of examples that are provided for that, all the way from soft skills, as Joe had indicated in the beginning, to career development assessment, to internships, and both unpaid and subsidized work experiences. So the issue of talking about career planning and work-based experiences really begins at age 14 and 15. The fourth is in the area of parent training and information. And this is where the family resource centers become an integral part of the process. But it also involves family-to-family supports, as well as advocacy approaches in working with the parents. And finally, it also involves providing services and supports to the family members. We have had our career service folks have done a wide range of family supports, all the way from assistance with housing for individuals who were either homeless or were going to become homeless, working with individuals through food programs, and a wide range. Immigration has been another area that's been addressed. So it's been the full gamut of support with those individual families. And then finally, the fifth area of intervention is other support. So it looks at youth development activities, engaging employers, working in the area of assistive technologies, and then also assisting in the areas of independent living skills development. That's a part of it. So those are the five categories. As I indicated, the points underneath those illustrate possible areas of interventions, but there's a wide range that we're seeing. We've just entered within about the last 6 to 8 months, where we have moved from the we're moving from outreach and recruitment and getting individuals enrolled to increasing the interventions. And we're seeing an incredible amount of creativity in the local communities with the children and the family members. Finally, on the issue of performance measures, these are the outcome measures that we're looking at the end of 5 years. One is increased educational attainment for the child. That's definitely a key element, and our expectation is we'll help them complete high school and look at opportunities beyond high school in the post-secondary area. Increasing their access to community services based on their individual needs. We'll look at improved employment outcomes, but because of working with individuals starting at 14 to 16, by the time the 5-year study is over, we'll be looking at individuals who are young adults. And we know that some will enter employment and others will still be continuing in the area of training and other developmental activities. But we do definitely want to look at employment outcomes. We want to look at increased exploration and understanding around SSA work incentives, and not just the SSA, other work incentives that might be available to them. As we've mentioned, we also want to look at improved understanding of financial and benefits planning that's part of it. And obviously, we also want to look and see if there's any reduction and post-program with regard to SSI benefits that are provided because the individuals have become self-sufficient. So those are the performance measures that we're looking at. And by the way, they're comparable performance measures through the other 5 projects that are funded under PROMISE. As of August 1st, this will give you an idea as to what's occurred, and I updated the numbers just a little bit this morning.
No problem.
On the left-hand side is the number of individuals that had been recruited by August 1st, and you'll notice that they're divided into the CalPROMISE Services Group and then the usual services group. We don't do that. Once a student is and their family have agreed to participate, then a large computer in the sky back in D.C. decides whether they're in the services group or they're in the usual services group. And we do provide an acknowledgement of different community resources for the usual services group and then provide all the interventions for the PROMISE group. Since the 1st of August, the number has gone up to 1,964. So we're about 63% of the outreach and recruitment that's required. We're supposed to hit our target by April 30th of 2016. We anticipate that we might hit that target a little bit earlier. They equally divide between the CalPROMISE Services Group and the Usual Services Group. We've engaged over 500 community organizations across those 18 LEAs and the Family Resource Centers. And those are community organizations that have provided at least one intervention or one contact with one of the participants. As I mentioned, 75 of the career service managers and their managers are being certified as benefit planners. We also started, and this was at the direction of the Department of Rehabilitation, and it's become an extremely value-added aspect to it, that 5 universities in the CSU are providing student interns that are supporting the career service staff in the individual programs and providing support to the child and the family. And so there's five CSU campuses that are involved. We've had just over 12,000 interventions that have occurred in this initial phase, which is very extensive. There's 16 family resource centers that are involved, and then obviously the involvement with the state agencies that Joe had discussed. So that's a little bit about the performance, where we're at now. I do want to emphasize that we're really driven by the needs of the student and their family. So while the numbers are important, the qualitative impact is of utmost importance. And I'll turn it back then to Joe.
Thank you, Fred. So as you can imagine, you know, operationalizing all of what you've heard in these first 21 slides is a small feat and takes a whole lot of partnerships. But really, what's really important about all this is at the end of this, when we look at the end of the study, what are we doing? And as Fred alluded to, I have routinely said that if we are doing in year six what we did in year zero, then I don't think we will have been successful. And so there's a lot of effort for us to identify what is taking place that we need to look at in a different way to make those kinds of impacts that have been described. Our partners and communities are supporting the policy and the systems change. If we're identifying system and policy change that needs to be occurring in year six and years out, we want to be sure that you and the rest of the partners that have been alluded to are positioned to support those policy changes, those systems realignment. And policies and systems have been aligned to create a seamless system for the student, for the family. And I suppose one way that I could use to sum this up is that in year six and moving beyond, that the policy and the system is driven by the need of the student and the family rather than the policy or system driving the student or the family. And I suppose to untangle that a little bit, it would be simply to say that regardless of system, it's seamless to that youth, to that family, so they can move from where they are into ultimately, you know, meaningful remunerative employment, independence, and equality. And I think that takes us to slide 23, and I'm not sure if that is Fred or Susan, so whichever one of you it is.
Mm-hmm. Fred?
We're open to, we wanted to be able to get through and open it up to questions and any of the areas that are of particular interest to you.
Okay, so that, here's the website for you all if you wanted to go online and check out the CaPROMISE website. And so thank you, Joe and Fred. We appreciate that presentation. So here's another question for all of you listening. Do you now have a little better understanding of the CaPROMISE program now that you've heard this presentation? Can you move your temperature slider to let us know if you benefited from that? Sounds pretty good. I'm seeing mostly positives. So I know that some of us still have questions about this, and maybe the presentation raised some brand new questions for you. So this is the time to ask them. Please click on the Ask a Question button in the top left corner of your screen, and then you can just go ahead and type in your questions. And we typically are unable to get to all of them, but we'll try to cover as many as we can in the time we have. I'd appreciate it if you could identify yourself as a parent or professional or self-advocate. It helps us to understand the question better. Please don't use the chat box that's on the bottom left for your questions. Use the Ask a Question button at the top, and we'll get to as many as possible. So let me begin. Second. Okay. Laura wants to know, how were the students selected for the study?
I'll start to that and then ask Fred to jump in. This is Joe. So what we did here in California is first we identified where the concentration was of individuals with who were on SSI to fit the profile for the study. And we then, Social Security then provided us with lists of names of individuals who were in that area. And then from that, you know, the outreach was done to identify individuals and families who were interested to participate in that study. And then from that, they're randomly assigned, as Fred mentioned earlier, to either the intervention group or the usual services group.
Okay.
Fred?
Yeah, they we identified the participants with Social Security. They sent us a list that were by zip codes. We correlated the zip codes to the individual schools. And the only criteria to be a part of that original list is that they had to be between 14 and 16, and that they had to live in that zip code. And then the local education agency received the list of participants for their community. And they went through and randomly started to contact those participants to see if they would be interested in participating. Initially, we focused on the 16-year-olds because on the day of their 17th birthday, they were no longer eligible. So we wanted to give as much opportunity as possible to get individuals involved. And the only selection criteria was that they were an SSI recipient.
Right. Okay. And also from Laura, she's very much participating. How long have the school districts been involved in the study? When did it begin exactly?
You want me to take that, Joe?
Yeah, please.
The project was funded on October 1st of 2013. With the Department of Rehabilitation, we developed the proposal beginning that prior, probably April. And the school districts were involved in the original design. There were four, I mentioned earlier, four regional managers who are school district employees. They were involved in the development of the proposal. All the school districts that are participating were requested to be a part of the study in that July and August period prior to funding. So the school district participation commenced virtually on day one of the funding and has continued with weekly teleconferences and a variety of other communication strategies from the beginning. So there's been really active involvement from the schools.
Fred, if I could just add one piece to that. I think it's really important also to note that what really allowed us to do this and to effectively get the study developed and engaged was we had a very long, rich partnership with a lot of our school systems, all of our school systems around the state. So this was not a project where we needed to establish a relationship to move on. It rather was a project where we had an established relationship, and a very good relationship, where we built on and built this project upon.
Okay, great. Let's see. Will CaPROMISE include support on how to choose appropriate housing as some of these individuals want to live on their own?
I'll let you take that one, Fred.
Okay. Yes, some of the individuals we anticipate will want to live on their own. At this point, the participants are primarily at, say, the 14 to 17 age range. The issue of independence and living alone really comes into that financial planning part that we talked about, and also working with the individual families. at this point, the major part of helping with housing has been with individuals who have lived, families that are living in transitional homes, or may either be on the verge of becoming homeless or have been homeless for a short period of time. So the major housing at this point has been more of an emergency standpoint. But we do anticipate that the issue of housing and looking at accessibility and living independently, probably more so in years 3 through 5, will definitely be a part of it. And we're looking at resources to provide that.
Okay. All right, another question. How is this pilot different from, or if I may add, work in conjunction with the self-determination law that regional centers are moving into? Is there any correlation between the two?
I think if I understand your question correctly, is individuals that where the state of California is transitioning individuals from developmental centers into a group community housing. How does this differ from that?
I think it has to do with how regional centers are offering the self-determination program, where families can choose their services instead of going through the regional center for the only the programs that are offered. So you can just say that there isn't any connection between the two, if you know the right answer.
Actually, we had that discussion at the last interagency meeting, mm-hmm. which was held back in, I believe, May, if I'm not mistaken.
Uh-huh.
And so there are some discussions with the Department of Developmental Services, but they're in their early stages. And there seems to be a connection that we should be able to develop, but exactly how that would work, we're not certain. But mm-hmm. the discussion did start back in May.
Okay. I have someone asking a question. I think it very much depends on certain factors. How can a family with a 14-year-old become a participant? Depends on their school district, for one thing, huh?
Well, I think it depends on their school district, one, and then two, when we receive those lists that Fred described and we're outreaching to them. So this was not so much soliciting out there, do you want to participate, you know, mm-hmm. by doing a broadcast, as it was reaching mm-hmm. out to them.
Individually.
Mm-hmm.
Right, like an invitation.
So if they see the school district listed among those that we're partnering with, and if they're in that school district, there's a possibility that they could be considered.
Got it. Okay. Let's see. There's someone who's... hold on a sec. Griselda says, I'm an advocate with disability rights. I think it would be important for DOR counselors to attend individual transition plan meetings and be part of the ITP process. I see a problem in San Diego and Riverside counties with a lack of appropriate ITPs being written. How can these issues be addressed?
Well, I would say that there are two separate issues. What we're doing with this study is pretty much what you've heard. I think the larger issue you're asking about is something that is required under the reauthorization of the Rehabilitation Act, which is the participation of our Department of Rehab counselor with the school and the student and the family in the development of their plan. And so, although that could be the same population, it's a bit of a different discussion.
Okay. Are regional centers involved in this, or is this California State Council on Developmental Disabilities part of this?
Well, I'll start that, and Fred, please weigh in. I mentioned earlier that there are five state partners that are key in this project, and one of them is the Department of Developmental Disabilities. And so they are on our steering committee, statewide steering committee that meets twice a year at least, as Fred described. At the local level, you know, there's a lot of local engagement, and so Fred, I'll defer to you on how that may look like at the local level.
Yeah, at the local level, the local education agencies have engaged with the regional centers, but it's primarily been on a as-needed basis that's part of that. So there's not a formal relationship statewide, but it really is done on a local basis. That's part of it. Some of the schools and the regional centers have a long history of working together, and that collaboration has continued. Others haven't had as strong a relationship, and we're encouraging that to be developed at the local level for individual students.
Sandra's asking, how do you address financial planning with families who live paycheck to paycheck and cannot save or plan for the future?
We're learning that as we go along. I'd like to say that there's a formula and we don't have that, but that's one of the areas that we know is critical. And so first we wanted to make sure that all the career service folks understood all the benefits available for participants. So that was one knowledge set that we felt everybody had to have. We're working with the Family Resource Centers to look at that area of financial planning, and that's an area that we know we're going to have to continue to deal with because it very much is a paycheck-to-paycheck issue. And it really is an education, but it's also understanding how to balance all the different demands that they have. So it really is unique to the person. And I would hope within a couple of years we'd be able to tell you, here's some things that have really worked. But we're in the beginning stages of that. And we know that part's going to be really challenging. No question.
Okay. One last question, I think. So if the interventions are deemed to be successful after the time period's up, will the control group be given the opportunity to start participating in those, or will they have aged out by then?
That's a research question. I'm going to leave that one to you, Fred.
Sure. There will be the factor of aging out as a part of that. But we definitely hope that as the interventions become successful, that those practices will be incorporated both in the schools but also used in the areas of post-secondary education. I'm using that in the broadest sense, mm-hmm. with regard to training programs, with regard to the types of strategies that Department of Rehabilitation counselors will be using, working with them. So while it won't have the same case management function that we have, we definitely hope that these interventions will inform practice and benefit the individuals that were in the usual services. Mm-hmm. We've also provided, the schools have provided a rich resource for the usual services families of resources that are available in their respective communities, and that is provided to those individuals and their families.
So I suppose it's yet to be determined at the end of 5 years whether there will be funding to continue with the career service coordinators and providing those sorts of intensive services.
We have not heard that more money is coming, at least not yet.
Okay. Well, stay tuned, huh?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Well, that ends our question and answer portion. So thanks, Fred and Joe, for the great discussion. And thanks for all of you attendees who asked your questions and listened and participated. So we hope you enjoyed the presentation and that you'll join us again soon for our next webinar, which will be on September the 24th. The topic will be post-secondary education for people with disabilities, so it very much is related to this topic. And so this concludes our meeting today. As promised, we're finishing just a little early to leave you time to fill out the evaluation survey. And please leave your browser open, and when the meeting ends, a short survey will automatically appear on your screen. We greatly appreciate it if you would provide some feedback to help us be better. Thank you, everyone. Thanks, Joe and Fred.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay. Thank you.
Bye.